Evening, wherever you might be watching from. My name is Pat Kemmer. I am going to be doing a presentation for you of cryptocurrencies. There's about two videos that we are going to do. So the first video that we are doing will cover cryptocurrencies. What are they? They will cover fiat currency also. What is it? So we'll start by first fiat currency, and then we'll cover cryptocurrency. And I'll also give you a history of where cryptocurrencies come from. So in this video, by the end of it, you should be understanding fiat currency, cryptocurrency, different kinds of cryptocurrency, and most importantly, how do cryptocurrencies work? So I'm just going to go to a presentation right now without any waste of time so that you are able to see what I am talking about. Right, in this slide, I'm going to be covering the evolution. When we come to talking about fiat currency is a global name that is given to all the different names of currencies of the world. So for us to exchange goods or services, we need to pay one another. And so we pay one another with what we call money and in different currencies. And those currencies, like I said, the global name for all these currencies is called fiat currency. But now let's talk about the evolution of money or fiat currency. When we go back in time, we started selling to one another using a bartering exchange. Bartering exchange means goods for goods. You will give me some goods and I will exchange to you some other goods. For an example, if somebody gives me a cow, for a cow, in order for me to make an exchange for a cow, most probably I might need to do a service for you. And depending on the size of the service that I must do for you, maybe I must do build a house for you, or maybe build a one room for you. And then after building that one room for you, then you will pay me with a cow. I have given you my services of building, and you give me a cow as a payment. So it was in exchange of service and goods for goods. And then later on, people started using gold. And then this is where the banks started. Banks started when people started using gold, because people did not want to carry gold around. It was heavy to carry. And so what they would do, banks started saying, we will save this gold for you. And in return, we will give you a piece of paper that shows that you are the one that owns this gold. And so maybe you take this piece of paper, you go somewhere. When you get there, you see something that you like, and you want to buy that type of a thing. But now the gold that you have is stored at the bank. So so what you're going to do is you will come to an arrangement and an agreement with the person that you want to buy things from. And when you guys agree, you will give them the piece of note from the bank to be able to say, the bank that is in the gold, I am now giving it over to you. The person that is holding the slip from the bank, that means he's the one who is the owner of that gold at the bank. So there was a system that happened from there. And then we moved from carrying around the gold and storing at the bank. Now we wanted, because some of the people, you did not want to use all of your gold at the bank. So you needed to use small fractions. So they made metal coins so that you are able to use the coins to pay. But now the coins became heavy to carry. Now we moved to what? To paper money. So I mean, with 100 rands, you are having 101 rands, you know? And so at the end of the day, they became, so you have put 101 rands into one piece of paper called 100 rands. So paper money started developing from there. So what you are seeing from the screen is that money was evolving. It moved from bartering to gold, to metal coins, to paper money. And then we moved from paper money, we went to credit cards, debit cards, check cards, and everything. Now we no longer carried paper money, where now we are starting to carry debit cards. And then from there, money evolved again. Now the internet is around, everybody is able to use the internet. We're a global community. Now we are using what? Electronic money, so that we are able to pay for goods and services that we want. But the thing is this one, there's a disadvantage with the system that we're using right now. That disadvantage is that, number one, the system is decentralized. You know, it's centralized. So what does it mean the system is centralized? It means it's controlled by banks and government. So there's nothing that you can do. Banks can print, they can tell the mint or whatever that printing company is. They can tell them how much tenders they want to print and everything. So even also, that will affect the price of and the value of the coin itself or the currency itself. And number two, the value is affected by inflation. So what happens is this, your money buys less with time. So you can put money at the bank, 100,000 now. If 100,000 can buy you 10 things now, 2 years down the line, the very same 100,000 will not buy you the same 10 things. Because what would have happened? The price of things would have gone up. The repo rate would have taken place inside of the in terms of the inflation that goes up. So what happens from there is that your money buys less with time. The more we go, the more the money loses. One of the study that was made that fiat currency loses 6% of its value every single year. So at the end of the day, your money keeps losing value over time. So, and then the other one is transactions, they take long time, though the banking system is improving now, but they take a long time nonetheless. And they have high fees that are connected with that. And then the other one is that it is easily corruptible. So fraud and counterfeiting and heists are able to take place there. So what happened was in the year 2008, cryptographers came together in the name of Satoshi Nakamoto. These guys came together and said, listen, we see how money works now. Can we use the very same system to go forward in the year 2040, in the year 2050, in the year 2080, as we are going forward into the future? Are we going to continue with the same system? We need a new type of currency, number one. We need a new type of system that records the currency. And then number three, we do not want institutions or government to be involved in this type of a thing, because, I mean, there's too many, there's a lot of politics going around, and there's too many things that are going around when people are controlling this. So we need a system that is able to control itself, that will be able to produce new currency for itself without the interference of anyone. And then most importantly, we need a currency that grows in value over time. We don't want the currency that when we are saving our money, later on our money is worth less than when we started saving it. So we want a currency that when I start to save it now, in a number of years, what is going to happen is it will grow in value. And we need a currency that can be trusted, that is not controlled by one entity, that the whole world can be able to see and be able to check the recordings of how the movement of the currency went. So they said, the only way to be able to do this, we need to go to a different currency. And so what happened was the birth of cryptocurrencies came to be. So cryptocurrencies is encrypted currency. Cryptocurrencies are not controlled by a central bank. They are not controlled by any entity. Cryptocurrencies are borderless. They are using a system that is borderless. The system of internet. You know, it is borderless. Anyone can go into the internet. There's no one who's carrying a dictionary around these days. If you want a particular meaning of a word, what do? You simply go to Google and type in the meaning, and then it will give you the meaning. There's no need to carry around a dictionary. So the internet made things easy. So they said we need a currency that will work in the internet, in terms of saying, if I want to pay with it, I should be able to pay with it, because the internet has made things so simple that if you are wherever in the world and you have WhatsApp, I can say good morning, you will get the message now, and you will greet me back, and we'll be able to carry a conversation and it will appear in real time. So we needed a currency that can do that without being controlled by any entity or central bank. So cryptocurrencies became borderless. And then also, what did happen? Cryptocurrencies are deflationary. They are not affected by inflation. Okay. So what happens? What does that mean? It means they are a long-term store of value. So if you are having a particular cryptocurrency right now, and it is worth a particular value right now, the longer you hold on to that cryptocurrency and it's traded in the open market, what's going to happen is the value of that cryptocurrency is going to go up. And so what happens is they are highly protected from theft, because at the end of the day, it's not only one computer that controls, it's a blockchain type of a system. Blockchain means there's a system called the blockchain that records the movement of these cryptocurrencies. When I say blockchain, I mean, if I have to break the word down, it's blockchain. So what does it mean? There is blocks that follow each other in a chain form. So one block comes, and inside of that block, there's information about the transactions that took place. There's information about the hash power. There's information about the address of the block, and also information about the contents of the block. So every 10 minutes, a new block is created, and those blocks follow one another just like a chain, you know. So that's why they call it a blockchain. So that records the move, it records the transactions that take place every single 10 minutes. You know, every single 10 minutes, a new block is formed. Every single 10 minutes, a new block is formed. And in that 10 minutes after a new block is formed, new cryptocurrencies are created. Every 10 minutes, new cryptocurrencies are created. So that is how the system is able to look after itself. And they use the triple entity accounting system, so that at the end of the day, this system is a digital ledger and is accessible globally by everyone. So one of the things that I love explaining this thing is that it's peer-to-peer, person-to-person. That means if I am paying you with cryptocurrencies, there is no one between me and you. There is only a machine between me and you, between my wallet and your wallet, or where the cryptocurrencies might go, move from where to where. So it's only a machine that records that movement. There is no government, there is no company, there is nothing. There's just these machines connected to the internet, working in the blockchain, and that is the thing. And now, this is the thing that I wanted you to see, is that cryptocurrencies are transferred from person to persons directly through the internet. And what happens is that the fees are very minimal, very next to nothing, actually. There's a new cryptocurrency called Electric Cash. That one, you can do transactions without paying fees on that one. So, and it's fast. That's the thing that we want. Right. And so what happens is this one. Every cryptocurrency that you are sending, it must go to a wallet address. It must go to a wallet address. What I've shown you now in front of you there, it's a wallet address. A wallet address is those long numbers there that are mixed together and everything. That is a wallet address. And then usually they are hidden behind the barcode that you see on your right. That barcode, when you take your phone, you scan that barcode, it will give you the wallet address and also the amount of coins that you need to send to whoever that you need to send to, right? And so you can buy with these cryptocurrencies from anywhere where they are accepted. There's a number of names of cryptocurrencies that are around, but the famous name is called Bitcoin. So whenever you see the sign cryptocurrency or Bitcoin accepted here, you can go in there and buy. Now, this is what I wanted you to show you. Remember, with fiat currency is a global name for all the names of the currencies in the world. Rand, dollar, maluti, pound, kwacha, yen, euro, all of that. It is a name. They are names of fiat currencies. They are the names of the individual currencies of different countries. But when you put them together, they are called under fiat currency. Now, cryptocurrency. Under cryptocurrency, you have many other names. We have over 6,000 names of these cryptocurrencies. The first name that everybody knows is Bitcoin. Bitcoin is a name of a cryptocurrency. Then we have Bitcoin Vault, another name of another cryptocurrency. Then we have Electric Cash, another name of another cryptocurrency. Then we have Ethereum, Zcash, Ripple, Dash, Litecoin, Monero, all these names are just names of cryptocurrencies that are used. And these names, these cryptocurrencies, they have their value that are traded with in the market. So for one Bitcoin today, I mean, I'm going to show you something. For one Bitcoin today, you have a value. It had a value in the last 10 years. It still has a value today. It's traded in the open market. So you're able to see that. Let me show you something that is very interesting concerning these cryptocurrencies. Let's look at the Bitcoin. Bitcoin from 2016 to 2021. You see, from 2016, it was moving very, 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 very slow. It was at a particular point in terms of currency. Then you can see the graph, it went up. Remember what I said. I said cryptocurrencies, their beautiful nature and character is that when you hold them for a long time, they grow in value. They go up in value. So you can see the Bitcoin, the 2016 to 2021, that it kept on growing up in value, going up in value to where it is today. If I have to take it in numbers, you could get yourself a Bitcoin. You could have gotten yourself a Bitcoin got 2010 in 2010 for around about maybe a thousand rands in 2010. Today, one Bitcoin is equals to 850,000. So if you had held on to that Bitcoin that you got in 2010 and you held on to it up to today, you'll be having 850,000 and you got it for about $1,000. The same thing that happened with Ethereum from 2017 to 2021. Look at what happened. The price of it went up, came down. And when the price comes down, or the value of the coins come down, some people tend to jump and say, yeah, this thing is a scam, this thing is not going anywhere, this thing, and then they tend to ignore the coins. And then all of a sudden, the coin goes for quite some time being quiet. It keeps going up slow. There comes a day when it shoots up and it goes very high. Then all of a sudden, people say, oh, we thought this thing was a scam, but it's not a scam. It's real. So people start wanting it. And they don't realize that you should gather and collect these coins when the value is down. And you should be part of a system that helps you to collect the coins while the value is down. So that when the value goes up, you have somewhere that you can go to go and collect your coins and change them to rands, and then you can be able to score big. Let's look at Bitcoin Vault. This is our new coin. It started in 2019. Now, what happened was it started growing very strongly, very strongly, until somewhere in July, then the value kept on going down. The value kept on going down. Now, the value has been down for quite some time. And what is going to happen? We know with the nature of cryptocurrency, the value is down right now. But are we giving in? We are not giving in. This is the time, in fact, to come in. This is the time, in fact, to start being part of a system that helps you to collect these coins right now so that you are able to maximize on the return when the value goes up. Whatever goes down must come up. So at the end of the day, we are patient with the value of Bitcoin Vault where it is. It will soon come up. But while it is still low, we are collecting it with our company that gives us those coins every single day. So you need to be part of something like that so that you are able to maximize. Right. So here I'm going to show you an example of a company. It's called, it's one of the retail companies in South Africa, Pick n Pay. They realized that cryptocurrencies are real. Cryptocurrencies are working. So they said, we know that people buy bread and milk and their daily necessities from us. What if a person comes to our store and they don't have rands to buy bread, but they have cryptocurrencies to buy bread? Are we going to turn them away? The company said, we are not going to do that. So we need to make sure that we are a step in front so that we are able to accept those people who are having cryptocurrencies as money to buy bread with. And so they came in and made this example of how you pay with cryptocurrencies when you can come to their stores.
So today we're going to do a different type of transaction at the point of sale. We're going to buy dried fruit using Bitcoin. So the cashier scans the article. I tell the cashier I'm going to pay using Bitcoin. In the meantime, I fire up the Luno app, choose the scan option, Electrum now makes a call to Luna, who now issues us with a QR code, which we now scan. And it tells you how many Bitcoin you're going to be spending. And off you go. So there you see the first Bitcoin transaction at a Pick and Pay point of sale.
Right. So in that example, we saw how Pick and Pay was accepting a transaction using Bitcoin. But now let's go behind the scene. Let's go behind what really happened when a person was paying with these Bitcoins. This is what happened. Number one, when they took out their slip at Pick and Pay and there was that barcode, this is what happened. When you took your, when the person took their phone and they scanned the barcode, what happened is this in the system of the blockchain. Number one, a transaction was requested in the network. Number two, mining machines, machines that verify the movement of transactions, they received that information. Once they received the information, they checked whether the currency that you want to save, that you want to send, it's sent to the right wallet address. So that is the thing that was checked to be able to say, yes, you are receiving this information. This person wants to pay or send cryptocurrencies to another wallet address. So they check whether the wallet addresses are the same. If the wallet addresses are not the same, that transaction will not go through. But if the wallet addresses are the same, then comes the next step of after receiving the information. What is the next step? The connected companies of miners. What they do is they get the transaction fees. So connected miners validate and get the transaction fees to be able to say how much transaction fees are going to take place for this transaction that's happening. And then after they all agree, it's not one company, it's machines coming from different companies. And then after they get the transaction fees, what they do, all of them, they supply at the same time. All of them supply their finding to be able to say, this is correct, that is correct, that is correct. Immediately after doing that, new coins are going to be taken out into the system. There is a competition that the companies play in a 64-digit algorithm. So at the end of the day, that's going to take place. Then what's going to happen is that your information of a transaction will be taken into a block. And then that block will be recorded. And then after recorded, it will be in the blockchain. So what is happening is that then the transaction is made complete. You see, once they said transaction completed, that means these steps, all of them from step number one up to step number five, everything has been completed, then the transaction is made. So this is what happens behind. And that whole process that is taking to verify the movement of the transactions, to verify the amounts and everything, that movement is called mining. That whole process is called mining. And this is where our company comes in and it helps to do this process. And there's an amount that the people get for doing that type of a thing. Right, let's go to the next one. Right, what did we learn from here? There's three ways to get cryptocurrencies. You can buy and hold a cryptocurrency, you can trade it, or you can mine. Right, number one, buying and holding. When you buy and hold, you must send your money to an exchange. And then when it gets to the exchange, then you use that money to buy a cryptocurrency from the exchange. And then you hold that cryptocurrency in the exchange for a period of time. That is what we call buying and holding. So they call it hodling, actually. Buying and hodling. You are holding that coin. You are just taking money, send it to the exchange, convert it to crypto, buy with the money crypto, and then they give you the crypto that you want, and then you hold that crypto for some time. Then you wait for the price to go up. Right. The second one is that you can trade. Trading means buying and selling. Buying and selling. That means you buy low, you sell high. Buy low, sell high. So that was, those are the things that traders do. They will always be in front of the system somehow, making sure that they are buying the coin when it is low and they are selling it when it is high, and they'll be pocketing some profit. And then after that, they'll be doing that all the time. That is time consuming and everything. They're using robots these days anyway, but at the same time, it's still, you can still lose money from there. if your settings are not right and all of that. And number three, the one that I love, this is consistent, this is constant. You are always getting your cryptos every single day. What does it do? It's called mining. Mining is the manufacturing process of cryptos to accumulate fractions of coins on a daily basis. So with mining, you partner with a company, and then every single day, based on the power of the package that you bought, they give you small fractions of the coins every single day. They have a contract with you that they will give you, and for the duration of that contract, you will be receiving coins every single day. The name of the game in mining is called patience. I love that one. That's the name of the game in mining. We are patient. We are not in a hurry. We are patient. At the end of the day, we are collecting the coins. We are waiting for the price to go up. And as soon as the price goes up, we know what we need to do with our coins. It is safe. The most important thing is you just need to do it with a reputable company that is good. So this is the thing that we are promoting and helping people to come and get. So you too, after this video, I assume that you will be able to go and get yourself the mining package and partner with a mining company and collect your coins very safely and make sure that when the price goes up, you know where to go so that you are able to change to rents and maximize. Now let's look at two scenarios. Here is one individual. They are saying, I'm going to buy and hold. So they take their money, they go to an exchange. They say, I'm going to spend $35,000 for to buy one coin. Let's say they do this in January 2021. So they take $35,000 and they go and buy a coin. All right. So they have got a coin, they bought it from the exchange. Now, while they are holding this one coin for the next 3 years, the value of the coin increases from being $35,000 to $55,000 in 3 years. In other words, they bought a coin for $35,000, they held on to it. While they are holding on to it, the next 3 years, the value goes up. What's going to happen? What has happened? They bought it at $35,000, the value has gone to $55,000, so they have made a profit of $20,000. So at the end of the day, they say, wow, that is good, you know, because this is what happened in the space of 3 years. So the estimated value of that coin in 3 years is $55,000. They bought it at $35,000, so they made a profit of $35,000, of $20,000. That is good. It sounds good and it is good, right? But another person says, I have the very same $35,000. Rather than buy one full coin, what am I going to do? I am going to go and partner with a company that is doing the mining. And so I take my $35,000, rather than buy a coin, I buy a mining contract with the company. So the company gives me a contract for 3 years. Now, while I am collecting fractions of coins for the 3 years, I paid $35,000 to buy my contract, right? And then I waited 3 years. So while I'm still collecting the coins, in this period of 3 years, I managed to collect 3 coins. The one person who bought for their $35,000, in the period of 3 years, they still have 1 coin. I managed to collect 3 coins in this period of 3 years from buying a mining package with the company. Now, what do I have? That means in 3 years, I have collected 3 coins. If 1 coin gets to be 55,000, what do I have? I have 165,000 from the 3 coins, because it will be 55 times 3, which will give me 165,000. And I only bought that contract for $35,000. Now I'm having 165, 3 times more than the person who did what? Who bought only once. So at the end of the day, it is very important to be part of a mining company that continues to give you these coins, and you become patient. And then as you collect these coins, the value of the coin in the market starts to go up, and then you start to maximize on that. Right. Up to that point, I just want to say to you, thank you for taking your time and be able to listen to what I have to say. In the next video, I'm going to introduce you to a company that is giving you and I this opportunity to partner with them so that we can collect the coins every single day. And then when the value goes up, we can have somewhere where we go and collect our coins and change them and we get more money. And one of the things that I love is that if anything happens to you and you pass away, you leave this legacy to your children. Your children can continue with the mining package that you have bought. They continue collecting the coins. And then when the value goes up, they can continue to benefit from it. So with those words up to so far, I want to say to you, thank you so much for taking your time to be able to come and listen to this video. I will see you in the next video when I explain the company that we are partnering with, when I show you their head offices, when I show you where the machines are seated, and when I show you the accounts in which how they work. You will be able to see physically how we get paid, because I'm going to open an account and so that you are able to see how we get paid every single day, and also introduce you to how we grow the company every single time. Thank you so much. See you in the next video.